What is good, guys? It's your boy G Marcus TV back with a brand new video. Please like, comment, and subscribe. And oh my god, I am very, very excited for this one right here. This one, I am doing a book review on my boy Will Smith entitled Will. And this one was written with Mark Manson. Mark Manson is my top five favorite writer. I love Mark Manson. For you guys that don't know, he's the guy that wrote The Subtle Art. I'm not giving up. Like, you putting these two together, yeah, this was a really, really good idea. So I got this one for free, but I bought the Audible book. I've been listening to it from the time it came out. It was worth every single minute. I really enjoyed it. So I went to the event that he had in Brooklyn in King's Theater. It was a really dope freaking event. Like, he gave out the books for free. Oh man, I was so happy to get the book. I was just like, wow, I just paid for audio, but it's all good though. It's good to have a physical copy. I like physical copies, but the audiobook, I like audiobooks better. Comment down below what you guys think. Do you guys like the physical or do you like the audio better? So I'm gonna give you guys a review on the book, what I thought about it, what I liked about it, what I did not know about it. The Audible book is in Will Smith's voice. So what I loved about the book too is, like, you see that it's really being told from him. Even though he had help writing this book, putting the book together by Mark Manson, you could just feel the authenticity. It feels like the book is 80-85% Will Smith and the rest was just Mark Manson just putting everything together. Will has this cockiness. He boosted a lot about his success, which is cool. I have no problem with that. But he definitely had this cocky demeanor to him to where it was just like, yo, I'm the sh-. My movies did this, my movies did that. Like, he's very competitive. Talked a lot about his insecurities. He said that he never knew how to fight. So he did not know how to fight until he started training for Ali. Like, everybody around him knew how to fight, but he did not know how to fight. Another thing he talks a lot about is, like, how fame and fortune, it really didn't really do much for him. Like, he was happy, yes, but he wasn't full. He always wanted more. He always wanted more success because he's a box office killer. Like, his movies made billions and billions of dollars. So he was a real box office killer. Something that I'm really happy said in the book was his career, his goals was more important than everything else around. And I was just like, wow. That kind of made me reflect and think about how I'm going about my career, what's going on in my personal life. It's just like when you have a dream that a lot of things become second. I love the fact, and I can really relate to this, he's never smoked weed, he's never did drugs. That's something I can relate to. Comment down below if you can relate or not relate, but I've never smoked weed. I never knew that about him. He doesn't look like the type that would smoke weed and drink heavy liquor, but yeah, he's not the type. And he also is a one-woman guy. His whole life, he always wanted one woman. Like, he knew from 5 years old that he wanted to be married and have children, and I found that to be very, very cool. There was just one girl named Melanie Parker, and that girl was like his first love, that he really stuck with this girl. Like, he wanted to marry her, have kids with her at a very, very early age. He said that when he started touring for the first time, like, he told his crew, everybody around him, like, yo, no groupies on tour. I do not want no groupies in the hotel rooms. But he did not want to jeopardize that relationship. He loved the girl. He loved the girl so much that he asked his mom, begged his mom for her to live with him. There's a reason why. I don't want to give too much of the book out. There's a reason why, but he begged his mom so she could come and live with them. The mom reluctantly did it, and he was just like, yo, he's not going to have no sex with her, and they're going to stay in separate rooms. But he broke the rule. Mom caught him giving her doggy style inside the kitchen. I was like, damn, Wills. The mom caught it, so you know what happened after that. But this girl eventually was the first girl to break his heart. She actually cheated on him. I was like, oh man. There was a lot of things he did not talk about. He even talked about Mr. Entanglement, if you know what I'm talking about. Like, he didn't talk about the situation with Jada and dude, I ain't gonna say his name. Like, the thing I liked about it, I really respect about this book, he didn't trash Jada. Like, I was really expecting him to trash Jada and just say, oh, they're in an open relationship and this and that. But he didn't really, he talked about issues that they had. They had a lot of issues, guys. Like, oof, they had some issues. He talks about that. But when it comes to the cheating stuff, he did not talk about it. So when him and Jada was going through what he was going through, he needed a break. He just took a break to really get himself. He went for 14, 15 days to Utah, a house that they had in Utah. It was no human contact. There was no cell phone, no TV. All he had was an iPad full of books loading. So he mentioned a couple, How to Win Friends and Influence People. He read the Malcolm X book, The Five Love Languages, A Man Think It, Moby Dick, Oneness, Iron John, Inspired, and The Power Path. Just to name a few, but he named a lot of freaking books. I'm just like, I can't even lie, in the audiobook, I had to rewind it a couple of times. I'm like, wait, slow down, Will. Like, slow down. Like, he didn't take his time with that one, but he read a lot of books and did a lot of self-reflection. He tried meditation. Like, he was just there by himself. Like, he said on the 8th, 9th day, like, he wanted to call somebody. Like, he said after a while, it's like, yo, he didn't want to be by himself no more. He's just like, yo, if I don't want to be by myself no more, why the hell would anyone want to be with me? Self-reflection is really good. Like, time apart is really, really good. And I'm happy he put that inside the book. He goes into details talking about his mom was really big on education. His mom loved education and everything was education, education, education. And his father was more of a guide about principles, rules, and like missions. Everything was a mission. Him going to the store to get some cigarettes for his pops at what, 11, 5 years old? Like, that was a mission. Everything was a mission. But his father was a really, really strict dude. But it was really sad because the father was very abusive to his mom and him. Very, very, very abusive. So I was like, damn. But he really loved his father and looked up to his father. His father made him build a wall. Him and his brother built a wall that he tore down and they had to redo it. It took them over a year to build a wall. It doesn't matter what it was. It could have been raining. It could have been snowing. He could have had a test. He could have been sick. Every single day straight for a year, he had to do it. It made him realize that, okay, whatever the situation is, there's gonna be a brick in front of you, because every day they had to put bricks. They had to perfectly put that brick down. So no matter what it is, no matter what's going on, failed movie, failed marriage, anything, you have that choice to get up and put that brick down. Basically, get up and do what you gotta do. Regardless of the situation, nothing is impossible. You have to do what you have to do. He revealed when he was like a kid that he was always a punk. He was always scared. So he said that there was a sex offender, a known sex offender, well, where he lived, a girl was going into his house. So instead of stopping a girl, he did not stop. He was so scared, thinking that the guy's gonna do something, thinking he's gonna come after him. He was scared to death and did not say nothing. So he said he had an imaginary friend in his head that was telling him, yo, do it, come on, do it, you have to let them know. And he never said anything to anybody. I've never heard him say that, never heard him talk about that in any interview before. So something that I found very interesting, that him and Jazzy Jeff, they were the first rappers to put out a double album. I thought it was Tupac with All Eyes on Me, but no, it was Will Smith and Jazzy Jeff. They put out a double album. And of course, for all you Will Smith fans out there, you know that he was the first rapper to win a Grammy. Something I was very, very, like, surprised about, Will Smith was arrested. Did you guys know that? I had no idea that this guy was arrested. I thought this man had a clean record. But he was arrested for something that he didn't do. His mans punched somebody, hit somebody, and they all got arrested, and he was in jail. I was like, what? I was shot to death. Like, he was arrested for aggravated assault. I'm like, really? Stuff like that? That's where you gotta watch the company you guys keep. Like, watch the company you keep, guys. Like, cause that, I'm like, that gave you a record? Oh, man. Quincy Jones had a birthday party and he made Will audition for the Fresh Prince. This is when he's broke. This is when he went bankrupt. For you guys that don't know, Will Smith had went bankrupt before he did the Fresh Prince. And that's the reason he even did the show, because he had to pay the IRS back. So he said that Quincy wanted him to do the show, picked him out, handpicked him for the show, and wanted him to do it inside his living room while the party was going on. He made his people move the chairs, and it was a funny, hilarious story. He actually says that in the event that I went to. He actually told the whole story, that Quincy was really drunk. He did his voice and everything. That basically, Quincy was like, yo, get your shit together. It's like, you gotta do this now. He's like, yo, I can't do this now. I know I need an acting coach, need this. Just give me a week. Like, and Quincy said, we can't do the week. Like, he just kept trying to push it back, and Quincy was like, no, the people that will greenlight the show is in the living room right now. So he did it, nailed it, of course he got the show. So it's a really funny story, but Quincy was drunk as hell. It was, and Will does a really funny impression of him. So something I found, like, really, really funny, I was just like, wow, did not know this part, but of course they went broke. Him and Jazzy Jeff went broke. Jazzy Jeff ain't wanna do the Fresh Prince. I was like, what? Are you kidding me? Every time he pulled up to the show, he would've got $10,000. And he didn't wanna do it. He was just like, yo, this is more your thing, not more my thing. But Will, being the guy he is, and I respect Will for that. Cause other people would've folded, they would've been like, no, I'm not doing it. Will pushed Jazzy Jeff to be on the show. Pushed him. He's like, dude, do you want to go back in your freaking mama's basement? He's just like, dude, you're going to make $10,000 an episode and you're really not going to do the freaking show? But he pushed him and pushed him and pushed him every single time they spoke. And they're just like, yo, you can get more. And I found that part funny. He said more money going on this show. And then after he said the more, that's when he did the show. So if it was girls or money, whatever it was, it made Jazzy Jeff do the show. I would've did that show, what? I would've did that 5,000 episodes. But something that really me up, he said that what made him quit the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, and I'm really mad because he didn't talk about how the third season after he paid his freaking taxes, he was basically done. He was done with the Fresh Prince. He didn't even talk about that. But he said what really made him quit was the sixth season when John Amos, that's the guy that plays the father in Good Times, John Amos did a couple of episodes, and as they was between rehearsals, he told Will that, yo, the executives, the producers, they don't give a shit about your family. Make sure that you set these guys off well. Basically, don't continue the show. I'm like, what? Like, I can't lie, I was really pissed off. I'm like, John Amos did that? That got fired from Good Times? Like, come on, man. I mean, I understand what he was saying about, yo, let's set them off right. So after that, he had a conversation with everybody, all the cast members, and say, yo, the next season will be the last season. And make sure in this year you take the time to start getting other gigs. I'm like, that's f***ed up. I didn't like that. Comment down below if you thought that was cool. I didn't like that. Will, of course, he wanted to be like a big, big star. So Arnold Schwarzenegger basically told him, if you want to be the biggest movie star in the world, you got to be worldwide. Your stuff cannot just be in America. You got to be successful worldwide. You got to go on tour worldwide, every country. You got to kiss babies, shake hands. And I was just like, yeah, the work effort got to be really, really, it got to be heavy. You got to be on your if you want to be the biggest star in Hollywood. So he basically followed Tom Cruise's stuff, but he wants to be better than Tom Cruise when it comes to the global stuff. So he said he got Tom Cruise's schedule and see how he was moving around. So what he did was he added, what, it was an hour or two to whatever Tom Cruise was doing, and he was trying to outdo him. So what he did was, for people who can't get into the movies, he did live performances for them outside the movie theater. Free things he did for them. I was just like, wow, so that was really good. I didn't know that part. He said his whole life he was trying to create that perfect family for him, Jada, and his sons, his two sons, and Willow. He was really trying to create that. It wasn't working. It wasn't working the way he wanted to work. So he said that they went on Oprah, which is really interesting. Cause I've seen that episode of Oprah. He was like, yo, like, you know, I finally got my dream, cause his show was Dallas. Like, that was his favorite show. This is the first time I'm hearing about this show. But in Dallas, I guess they was like the perfect family on that show. And he said that he really wanted to be that. And he said, I finally got my Dallas family. And Jada was just like, you know, Dallas got shot, right? I couldn't believe it. Shout out to Jada. She's a true Virgo. She's like, that's a killer. And that's how the chapter ended, which was so hilarious. I'll tell you guys one more thing about the book that was very interesting. He said that, you know, his whole life he was a people pleaser, he was competitive, and he said that he always had this obligation to the fans. Like, yo, no matter what, I can feel sick, I can feel unhappy, I can feel like shit, but no matter what, I'm gonna take a picture, I'm gonna sign an autograph. As he's fixing himself, because there was a lot going on, him and Jada's marriage was just going down the drain, it was just turned to a shit storm. So like, he was just doing like a lot of work, he was working like constantly, so he just wanted some time for himself. So he went into a gym, and the gym was empty. He was in the gym by himself, and a guy with a British accent came in and started recording. He was like, hey Will Smith, can you just say hi to my cousin? My cousin has Down syndrome. And Will puts the phone down, and he just said, no, I don't want to do it. And the guy was just like looking at him like, you're crazy. Like, yo, he has Down syndrome. Like, he loves your show, The Fresh Prince. Like, this is the only thing that makes him happy. And Will, he said in his head, he's just going back and forth. Like, yo, do it, don't do it. Like, I don't want my privacy. Like, he was just going like really crazy in the head. And eventually he just told the guy, no, because I don't want to. And it was like, wow. He said he went back to wherever he was staying and he started crying. He was bawling crying. Like, he was really mad because he felt like, yo, this innocent guy, like, he had to feel the wrath. But I would say that this book was a really, really good book. I would give this book an 8. A solid 8 I would give this book. The only reason why it's not a 9 or a 10 because he left so much stuff out. Now, the entanglement, dude, I can understand because you're not supposed to acknowledge some sucker shit like that. But other than that, it's just like, come on, man. You left out so much important things. How you leave out the Wild Wild West thing? He mentioned the Wild Wild West, but he didn't go into details with it. How you didn't mention the Matrix situation, like how you turned down the Matrix for the Wild Wild West. How you didn't mention that? How you didn't mention, like, basically how you guys were more in an open marriage? But, you know, I guess not everything is everybody's business, so I understand. I can respect it. It was a really solid book. I definitely enjoyed it. It was worth the 2 days. I tell you, I was spending days, like, I was at work listening to this book. I was at the gym listening to it. I was everywhere listening to this. Like, I was like, yo, I gotta finish this book. I need this book. The fastest I've ever read a book in my entire life, but I definitely enjoyed it. Comment down below if you guys are gonna get the book. If you guys have the book, if you're a fan of him and you know, you bangs with, like, you rock with him, definitely get the book. Like, he did a really good job. It showed him from when he messed up, he immatured, like when he was very, very immature, to where he grew up as a man. Like, I really, really enjoyed this book. So definitely, guys, make sure you guys like, comment, and subscribe. Definitely the notification bells. And definitely check out other book reviews that I have. I have a whole bunch of other book reviews. My latest one was on Gabriel Union's Do You Got Anything Stronger? Like, definitely check that book review out. So, yeah, I love you guys. Thank you guys for watching me. Thank you guys for supporting me. It's always love. It's your boy, G Marcus TV, signing off.
Got it. That's a wrap.